So we worked with strings, we worked with numbers. I think we're ready for dates. I say that with a heavy sigh because dates come with some extra complications. They're one of the more difficult data types to work with in any programming language. The most common thing we need when working with dates is simply, I need the current date and time. We use this a lot when we're logging errors or saving records in databases. We want to know when it was saved or when that record was written or when something happened. So the way to get the current date and time is by using the DateTime library. Now, we haven't covered libraries yet. Trust me on this one, we're going to get there. So for now, don't panic. Just know that I'm using a function that is in a library. This is a very Python type thing to do. There's a lot of libraries that do cool stuff that save us a lot of time. They are your friends. So I'm going to use the DateTime library, and in particular the DateTime function in the DateTime library to ask for current date and time. So we'll just take a look at that and see how it shows in code. So the line there, from DateTime import DateTime, that's basically saying, get me the DateTime function from the DateTime library. More on that later in the libraries module. And then I can call DateTime now, and that will return the current date and time. And notice, hey, I'm trying to be good with comments here. I'm adding comments to my code so I can remember all of this. So the now function returns a DateTime object. So I can say today is, we were learning about data type conversions. If I just pass it current date, it'll go, what? One's a string, one's a date, I'm confused. That's okay. You can just convert your date into a string, just like we could convert numbers into a string, so we can print the output out on the screen. So I now have a way of getting the current date using DateTime now, and if I can convert a date to a string data type, I can even combine it and display it on outputs. There's a whole bunch of functions you can use once you start playing with date times. That's why they're so wonderful to work with. So again, I go ask for date time now. So I'm storing that in a variable called today. And then I can display today's date. So that's the same code I had before. But you'll actually notice on the top, I've added another function I want to use. It's called time delta. It's in the same library. It's in that date time library. But it's kind of cool because it allows me to say how many days from today or how many weeks from today something is. So I can define a time period of 1 day, and it's a time delta of days equals 1. If I wanted days equals 3, it would be 3 days. If I wanted to measure a week ago, I could say weeks equals 1. And I simply say, so yesterday equals today minus 1 day. Now, think about how complicated that really is, because if today is the 1st of March, today minus 1 day, well, that's 28th of February. But wait, was it a leap year? If so, then it's the 29th of February. I don't want to have to write programming logic that figures all that out. So it's much easier for me to use this time delta function and let the date magic of Python work and say, just what was the day 1 day ago? And then I can just print that out on the screen. So today was, when I printed the slide, it was the 6th of June, and then yesterday was the 5th of June. So time delta and these features really make dates worthwhile and save you a lot of time coding. What it comes down to is when you're working with dates, if there's something you want to do, there's probably a function in DateTime or another library that'll do it for you. If you find yourself trying to count how many days in a week or months in a year or anything like that, chances are there's a function that'll do it for you. Save yourself some time. Now, what if I'm printing a date on the screen? By default, it was displaying a very long date there. It was date, time, hour, minutes, seconds, milliseconds. If you want to format it differently, you can absolutely just request parts of it. So I can ask for current date.day. So current, I've taken date time now, the current date and time, stored it in a variable called current date, and then I can say, just give me the day portion, just give me the month portion, just give me the year portion. There's also one for hours, minutes, and seconds. And that way, I can decide what part of a date is important to me when I'm either saving that data or using that data or displaying that value. Now, sometimes somebody will give you a date and then you need to store it as a date. Okay, maybe that doesn't make a lot of sense, but think back to what I was saying in the numbers module when I was talking about when you use the input function and you ask for a value, it always gets stored as a string. So I say, hey, when's your birthday? And it says, I say, my birthday is on the 5th of June, 1999. Yeah, we'll go with that. And then you want to store that value, because right now it's a string, you want to store it as a date. One of the things that's more complicated is when you take a string and you say store it as a date, you have to know, was a date given to you in day, month, year, or as month, day, year? Were you passed in a two-digit year or a four-digit year? Did they separate the day and month with slashes or dashes or just spaces? Whew, this is one of the reasons dates are so much fun to work with, or so challenging to work with. So if I run this code here, you'll see I've used the function strptime. So this will basically allows me to say, here's the format I will be receiving. So I am expecting a date format, which is day, then month, then year. If you look up the documentation on this function, it'll tell you all the little abbreviations you use for two-month year, two-digit year, four-digit year, month, day, etc. And then I can take that string that was received when I use the input function, convert that into a date function. Now, that seems like a lot of work if all I'm doing is displaying the date on the screen. But remember, there's some really cool functions that come with the date function, things that allow me to add and subtract days and so on. That's why it's worth sometimes taking a date value that's stored in a string and actually converting it into a date time object. If all you're doing is storing it, you can just leave it as a string. But if you want to play with those cool functions, you need it to actually be stored as a date time. And that's when you're going to need that strip time. So then I can do things like say, what was the day before my birthday? So once I've converted it using that strp time function, then I have the ability to use that time delta function we saw earlier and find out what was the date one day before my birthday and so on. Awesome. But as soon as you start doing this in your code, you're going to want to add some exception handling, because eventually someone's going to enter a value, and the format they enter, they might enter the 30th of February, or they might enter month, day, year instead of day, month, year, and boom, your code's going to blow up. So let's make sure we handle exceptions gracefully if somebody enters a date in the wrong format, rather than having it just blow up in their faces. So error handling is also very important, and we're going to cover that in a later module.